Luktarogar, everybody, and welcome back to the Heroes of the Storm Summer Championship live from Jönköping, Sweden, here at the DreamHack Summer venue. And we couldn't be more happier because we have another playoff stage here at this great stage, actually. It's looking really amazing, doesn't it? And the viewers here out there, and of course the viewers at home, are very excited to see E-Star Gaming versus the reigning Korean champion. That is, of course, Team Tempest. Now, there aren't really many teams left in this tournament, and I'm pretty sure that these teams that are still in here are considered to be the strongest in the world. And that is actually a good point for me to introduce my fellow panel members, and all of a sudden, I feel very tiny and meaningless next to these giants. I don't even know where to begin.
Keldor,
the last game, different. The last game made me grow a couple of inches.
A couple, to say the least.
All right, so no, Jayhaw, how are you doing, and how did you just enjoy the last first
I like the view
series?
Up here, by the way. I it like the view
nice,
up here.
Right? It is right, nice. Right, right. So far, so good. I mean, we saw a killer series. The fact that we saw a game taken off of MVP Black, perhaps that's a way, as Kendrick is shrinking through. Perhaps that's something that the winner of this can get confidence from, the fact that they know we saw East already take a game, Tempest beat them, My Insanity take a game. MVP Black looks more and more mortal by the day, but at the same time, the minute they get beat, they don't like to lose.
You call that mortal?
I mean, maybe like a wound, and then like he's just like, wait a minute, I'm not done.
At least they've got an Achilles heel for now.
Yeah, it showed that they could bleed.
And speaking of which, we're joined by Team E-Star's coach here, Latod. How are you doing, and how do you like your new job?
As always, totally unbiased here. They lent this to me. I mean, E-Star, you know, big fan of them. They've showed a lot of good things here already, and I guess they're the last hope to see a non-all Korean finals here potentially, if they were to somehow make the miracle happen and beat Team Tempest in semifinals. So a lot of pressure on their shoulders, and we'll see what they can do.
That actually makes for a great transition, because we can now take an updated look, or not an updated look, but just a look in general at what this Road to Summer Championships actually looked like. There we go. We see so many regions. They send teams like Team Navantic, PBA from Taiwan, E-Star Gaming from China. I mean, we can't really name them all because the roster here is so stacked. And as we're getting closer to the grand finals, of course, more and more regions will drop out. And so far, it's just down to the two usual suspects here, China and Korea, Jayhaw.
Yeah, China, Korea, and again, he talked about the potential for an all-Korean final, and it's something that we've gotten a little bit used to over the last two championships, the fact that the Asian scene has completely dominated Heroes, and it shows that they're on a complete another level than the rest of the world right now, and I think that I wouldn't be surprised if Korea does make it, but at the same time, where you said it's a miracle for China and E-Star to make it in, I don't think it's that much of a miracle. We were just talking about that. I think this is much more even than we're giving them credit for.
What I personally like is that we at least have the hope to finally like close the Western scene a little bit to the Asian. Because if you look at other games, especially when we're talking about Blizzard games like StarCraft II, for example, the Korean dominance has been established for a long, long time. In Heroes, there is still dominance, but we at least see some potential that at some point it might change, that we might have a fighting chance here. But of course, it's absolutely inspiring to see how good these teams are.
And for those of you tuning in a little bit later, we can now show you the updated bracket once more. Of course, we are now in the bottom tier here, E-Star Gaming versus Team Tempest. And from an insider, I actually received a little bit of information here, namely that Team Tempest, or at least single members of Team Tempest, are a little bit nervous when it comes to facing E-Star Gaming. Todd, do you have any explanation why that is?
I mean, it's a big stage. Some of these guys haven't necessarily, you know, played on the biggest stage. You know, they came all the way to Sweden here to, you know, try and win a big world championship. So obviously you can let the pressure get to you. They play in front of a big audience as well. Like the arena filled up very nicely here today. So this definitely could affect them. I think that's pretty much it.
Yeah, so let's not forget, I mean, Team Tempest is the Korean champion, but the team itself isn't really used to playing on the big stage like, say, for example, MVP Black, because not all the players are that experienced when it comes to offline events. Do you think that could be a big issue or a big factor to decide the outcome of this next series, Jayhaw?
I think early on, sometimes we do see that as a factor, but they've been here a few days now. I don't think that nerves are going to be as big a factor. Yes, as Tana just pointed out, the stage is set. The crowd is fuller than we have seen it yet, and they are here for some of the best heroes, and I'm curious if any of that will put the pressure on them, as these guys were just talking about?
I think they're definitely experiencing pressure, especially if you're familiar with the Korean culture. They are in under a lot of pressure to perform here. They are the champion, they come into this. And for me, it's personally very interesting to see how they have grown. They played already against MVP Black, not only in the final in the Korean season, but also before that. And they had great drafting, but the execution was more than lacking. They played in those cases, they misplayed a lot. Then they changed it up. They still had the same drafting, but they played a lot better. So right now they find themselves again in a spot where they have a lot of pressure on themselves and they have to do both. And I think we might see them sweat at some point.
I got to speak to some of their players and I was asking them, how do they think they're going to be able to deal with the style of drafting from E-Star and the uncharacteristic heroes that they play? And they were telling me that they just think their meta is better over in Korea than the Chinese meta.
All right, but without further ado, because we actually lost enough time already in the previous best of five, let's get straight to the nitty-gritty and hype it up for the next two teams that are going to dug it out between themselves in the second semifinals of the day. Everybody in the studio, of course, and everybody at home, give it up for E-Star Gaming versus Team Tempest. All right, guys, this is it. This is the chance to make it to the finals. These two teams are here for a reason. We've talked about it already. This could easily be the most contested series that we're gonna have all weekend. China versus Korea. Is it gonna be China and Korea in the finals, or are we gonna see an all-Korean finals if Tempest is able to pull it off?
It is a massive rivalry, and I really, really like that we have this game now in the second semifinal. We have MVP Black already waiting there, sitting back tight there, watching this series, and I expect a lot of aggression coming out of those two teams.
Absolutely. I mean, they have a stacked roster and they know exactly how to play Heroes of the Storm. It is once again also a clash of playstyle. We have pointed that out earlier. China, known for their aggression, whereas Korea is all about sticking as a group and executing these clean team fights.
Absolutely. Tempest, known for their team fighting. I had the chance to speak to Xiaoti. I asked him about it and he doesn't have the best of English, but he kind of laughed it out, looked at me and said, E-Star, team fighting very good too.
I mean, keep in mind, some of the members are going to be retiring, or at least have already talked about retiring after this. This could be their last stand. This is their chance to go out on top, and right now is a good chance to get to the finals.
I mean, especially when we're talking about Xiaoti, for example, talking about the Spring Championship again, like he had massive problems there. There were health issues and everything. So he's always been one of those factors of the team that they have relied upon. He has the experience. But it was a big blow to them, and right now he's talking about retiring, and this is, of course, one of these things where they want to make it happen for him as well.
Right. And, of course, the first team is now going to get a little bit of a more precise introduction. We're talking of Team Tempest, the reigning champion from Korea, and they are here to prove that Korean Heroes of the Storm is more than just MVP Black.
They're going for core, and there's Johanna. She comes in again. That Immortal Sylvanas with the value. The keep is already down, but there's the kill against Sylvanas. She is fighting up, but look at that core. Tempest, a completely wrecking my insanity.
E-Star가 강한 팀이라 생각해서 방심 안 하고 그래도 열심히 하면 우리가 쉽게 이길 수 있을 것 같아요.
As Paradise taking a lot of damage there. Tamina whirlwinding through the middle of this. That's a great force ball. Will steal in Rengar. He gets blown up under that. And that will be a Pronisher going over to Tempest.
예, 목표하던 것 중에서 하나를 이루게 되어서 그리고 형이랑 하는 그런 것도 있기 때문에 다른 팀원들이랑도 엄청 좋을 것 같은데 그러니까 말로 표현은 못할 것 같아요.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that was Team Tempest, a team that was founded by two brothers, Hyde and Lockdown. Lockdown even came from MVP Black. It was not an easy choice for him to make because at that point, MVP Black was by far the most successful team, but they still created that new roster, and boy, does it look strong. The only team so far that is still undefeated.
I mean, you talk about looking impressive. I remember before we ever showed up here, I was talking with Gillian Dreadnought, and they were talking Lockdown as if he is a god, and he has shown why he has lived up to the hype all weekend. That guy right there,
all about that money. Did you see it?
Look at him. Look at him. He is confident, guys. That is their all-star right there amongst many. It's like an entire all-star team, but that guy is somebody to look out for.
That was, by the way, also not a money sign. That's a Korean sign for heart.
Oh, I am so sorry. But I'm pretty sure he's here for the money as well.
It's a huge trend in Korea, actually, right now. To do exactly that. But yeah, of course, he's definitely not going to say no to the prize money. Don't get me wrong, but that was a shout out to the fans.
Korean
right there.
Culture cool. by Kaldor.
There's a reason I'm on the panel, yeah.
Yes.
That guy is my favorite.
And there's a reason why I'm on the host, you know?
Look at his fashion.
It's been eccentric all week.
Would you be
able
to rock it like this?
Is that a message to North America? J-Ho, can you explain that?
I don't know. North America is still in the tournament, apparently.
Yeah, see, he's representing. He recognizes the NA scene. He's like, hey, NA has some brothers on their team. We've got a couple on ours. There's a mutual bond there. I'm throwing anything out there right now.
Oh, is that the Koreans Mexi style? Is he pulling it off? The staring contest has commenced here.
All right.
Oh, he blinked.
Okay, we might not beat them in Heroes of the Storm. We are definitely beating them in the staring contest. I am willing to pitch in for a prize pool because Smexy's actually sitting in the audience.
Right?
We can make this happen.
Right, we can definitely make it happen. But yeah, as we said, Team Tempest, of course, a team that looks incredibly strong when it comes to fighting as a unit. We pointed that one out as well. And, you know, it's really cool to see that a team that hasn't really made a name for themselves before the Korean Super League, of course, is now here to demonstrate that Korea overall is more than just MVP Black. You know, you see so many good teams there, not just here at the global stage, but also during the entire Korean season. I think that Korean region is very fun to watch in general, guys.
I have touched upon it already a bit earlier. I saw them play, I think it was the quarterfinal against MVP Black, and I was massively disappointed. I loved that draft. Yeah. I watched it live, and I was just like, this is an amazing draft. This is brilliant what they are doing. And then they lost the game, and they were stomped, but they should have won it. And I was just like, not quite sure what to think of them, but they stepped it up so much since then. It is amazing.
And although China is decimated to just one team representing the region, E-Star Gaming is not a small obstacle to overcome, and they will tell you why in the next video presentation.
In the last moment, Rich is low but pops the army, tries to keep himself alive. The lockdown is Sylvanas, like MVP with four heroes, but everybody's solo. This is insane.
Tumi stays alive down the bot. It's absolutely crazy here. Shouty is still alive too, and he can go back in, and there he goes. He's on Rich here. Looks like Rich will secure one kill.
之前练习的比较少，然后其实问队伍问题我知道还是存在的，然后短期之内也解决不了太多，但是我希望明天大家都放开包袱吧，放开压力，放开包袱去好好发挥，然后不要有太多遗憾就可以。
Yuli there going in.
There's the Divine Shield. He's going after the Ten of Morales. That shield go down, but there's
oh my gosh!
The mosh pit. It's huge.
我把他们当作是我，就是以前我的理想是想拿世界冠军嘛。现在的话，我的梦想就是想赢他们一次嘛。
Tyrael's pass is going to get a lot of value, and the mosh pit, Gilly.
Oh, the mosh pit, Divine Shield on Zingzi, 2 Hammer of Justice takes out Sonya. Kael Goss goes down. Oh,
that's
that
a five-man wipe. All right, with excellent team fighting and fearless aggression, E-Star Gaming is here to prove to the world that China is the next upcoming region in Heroes of the Storm to dominate the world scene.
I mean, I don't know if ETC gets through today. We saw the most epic mosh pits in like tournament yes. history on the games from E-Star. I'm wondering if we're going to see the same today.
They played amazing, and I have to say that what I really love here is the way that they are approaching this tournament. The attitude really stands out. Everybody stands in our way. We're going to take them down. We are the champions. I was watching this. I got goosebumps.
We all
like,
looked
oh
at each
God.
Other on yeah. the stage like, that guy is for real.
I think on the day that they played as well, Kael'thas went like 6-3, and all the three losses that he got were every time against E-Star. So they must know something against how to play against that one guy in particular. But I love that this is a clash of styles, by the way, because E-Star, they've got their own pocket picks. They love the Tychus. As soon as there is like one warrior, and there is always going to be one, at least it seems like, you know, they are kind of already thinking about him, and they've done pretty well with him in some of their games. So are we going to see this kind of play here come out from them again? And is it going to throw off Tempest?
Combine the two things that you just mentioned. Being able to land those deadly mosh pits and not being afraid of Kael'thas. These are two virtues that can really become quite crucial when playing against Team Tempest.
We've seen both of those heroes dominate throughout the week. I mean, yeah. ETC, especially when you pair them together, ETC, Kael'thas, we saw how well that did. But when they were separated, we saw that they were effective in their own rights. And
this guy, Tiger, by the way, plays an excellent Rhaegar.
This is the aggressive.
He is so aggressive on that Rhaegar, the way that he positions himself, the way that he hunts people down. Every single time you see a Rhaegar player from a Western team get in that position, immediately the first reaction that you have, he is so far out of position, he's going to get jumped. If a Chinese player does it, I don't know how they do it, but they keep him alive every single time. And it's that kill potential that they subtly represent with that hero that is absolutely crazy.
He actually plays like he does know that you can no longer cast Ancestral Healing on himself, right? That's the way he plays Tiger, that is.
He plays like if he played Bruiser maybe before. Like he was a main Zeratul, so he always kind of come in from behind thinking he's cloaked, but like not really. And he does very well with it, but if Tempest have paid attention to this and they kind of wait for him, they could punish him very hard if he does the same.
Definitely. If there is a team to shut down guys that go too far into their phase, it's definitely going to be Team Tempest. For now, though, the first battleground of this best of five is going to be Infernal Shrines, ladies and gentlemen. This is a map that is very open, very much space to move around, to rotate around your opponent, and of course to use niche picks. Very here and now.
I mean, it might be an opportunity to roam around, but when the objective comes up, that is the time to fight. You want that Punisher on your side. We've seen different strategies come out all week. We saw Cho'Gall even, which was a little bit crazy, but Sylvanas pays dividends on this map. I'm sure one of these teams is either going to ban or pick her up because she is very strong here.
Zul as well. He's pretty popular and does very well, and we've seen him come out before.
Am I the only one that's excited that Tune the Spider Queen is going to be map number two and a potential fifth map is going to be played on Garden of Terror? I mean, did you see that?
Yes. We had it over here on the monitor. I'm showing Kendrick like Garden of Terror. If this goes game number five, what?
And look at this draft starting off with bans on Falstaff. The global immediately shut down Kael'thas. He gained so much value. It's not only that ETC Kael'thas comp, it's on this map in particular where just those living bombs alone are so strong. And that means Illidan.
You know, what's really interesting, the way that Illidan has made it through is that whenever he does make it through, he makes it to the later part of the draft. And I believe it's by the team that picks second because they have their first two picks. They can see the direction E-Star is going. And it's kind of interesting to see the back and forth strategies to let Illidan through.
Let's think about Illidan for a moment, like globally. He's a hero that in nearly every region gets banned out first. But a lot of teams have looked at this and have said, well, there's two approaches. Either we ban him out every single time, but then we lose a ban. Or for this tournament, we develop a strategy or two how we can deal with him. We saw that My Insanity draft against Illidan. It worked very well. A lot of teams have similar draft for these situations. This is one of the main reasons why in a situation like this, there's a lot of hesitation taking that Illidan this early because you expect your opponent to have something.
Absolutely. And E-Star in the interview, they were, you know, saying a little bit that they thought they didn't practice enough. They still had some problems they needed to fix and they didn't have time to fix. So I'm not sure that they could afford to do either. Like, it's a very hard choice for them to either go for an Illidan or let the opponents get away with picking it.
Twofold right away. Zul, one of the best heroes on this map because of his lane presence, because of his objective clear. And he is a hard counter to Illidan. That Bone Prison, everything that he can do. Keep in mind, Shade, if he goes at level one, neutralizes a lot of what Illidan can get off those auto attacks.
And let's not forget that Zul is also a hero that the Chinese scene in particular adores. They play him in nearly every single setup. Think about those combos that we've seen from X-Team on the first few days. Full melee with a Zul centered around him for the lockdown, for the engage. They love to just crush opponents and run over them, and they are following that style again.
You know, one of the things that I love when you have a heavy melee comp is running the Sylvanas, especially if you can pick it up, which Tempest might be able to do if it does make it through the ban phase. But having Sylvanas,
I love it.
Level four, I'm telling you, that the Lost Soul talent, which spreads the Shadow Dagger and has the cooldown on it, that works so well on this map.
look at this draft already. Greymane, super high in the Chinese meta. He is such a valuable hero for them. They have a Sonya, they have a Greymane already. That's dual. They are here with the aggression that we've been expecting for this game.
This is basically a trademark China draft here. Like, hey, oh, you know what? Three heroes that can go right into your face and hurt and make you bleed. And I just love the stereotypical approach here from E-Star Gaming. And they are not afraid to actually use their own playstyle to come over Team Tempest.
And then two logical bans, I think, here on ETC. And then Illidan, the healers, not been prioritized at all here so far from either team. I'm pretty sure E-Star would be pretty happy with getting a Rengar if they can for Tiger.
I'm really excited to see what kind of frontliner they're going to take here. Ethereal, for example, is something that we have seen coming out of those Chinese teams a lot. The idea always being you go in deep, you try to force the engagement, you drop the sanctification. And from some of these teams, we've actually seen the sanctification is being used a bit too early, but it's still an amazing idea behind it, and this is something that we could see in this draft too.
I don't think you could have said it any better. If Tempest doesn't try and take it away, and it almost seems like it's going to be difficult too with their composition, but if that falls into the hands of E-Star, that's a pretty scary, you know, combination that's going to be coming towards you.
Keep a Thrall in mind. He is an option here too. I mean, we have seen also a Kerrigan's on this map. If you go for a Tassadar and a Rhaegar, you already have a lot of support to enable one of these frontliners, and there are very few left at this point. Nuburak has filled this role every now and then, but there are options for Tempest now.
On the flip side, though, I really want to see Nuther getting picked up by E-Star Gaming. I mean, the amount of extra protection you can provide a Sonya or a Greymane with would just be perfect when it comes to engaging the team fights later on.
An Uther Tyrael right now, I mean, we've talked about it time, like all the time. And the fact that you get the sanctification, and then if you need to, you have that divine shield for that extra protection. But it's up to Tempest to really try and counter a lot of that. And this is one of the things I was curious about. He can eat up front lines, but at the same time, the fact that they don't have a strong back line, it kind of worries me right now. Tychus kind of falls into that middle range, but Kaldor.
I mean, here comes the Tyrael. We've been expecting it. They could play Karazim.
What?
I would prefer Karazim over an Uther, I have to say. I mean, look at the lineup. Think about it. If he jumps in, think about a level 16 Karazim with this setup and they go deep. How do you kill that? How do you stop that?
I want to see either Sylvanas, and I know that people are going to call me crazy. Lunara at Splintered Spirit level 7 against the heavy melee comp spreads a lot of damage. Yes, Karazim can heal up it. I can hear Dread probably already arguing with me about that with Echo of Heaven at 7 for Karazim, but...
There we go. There she is. Loving it. They go for the Kerrigan. I've already been talking about it a bit. You have the Tassadar. You have the Rhaegar. Kerrigan is going to provide you with a lockdown. There's a lot of choke points on the shrines that you can use. And having Tychus here, he is one of the best damage dealers that we currently have in the game, if you can keep him safe.
Looking at his draft, it feels like safe to say we're going to have some serious fireworks here, by the way, on our hands.
I can't remember who was up here, but they talked about it, and I know they were talking. It might have even been Wolf, but he was talking about how if you're going to have a Tychus, make sure you have a Tassadar on hand, and maybe that was the early pickup to be able to keep Tychus, because he has some survivability in the sense that he's strong enough to stay alive, but to have that extra shield on him when the dive comes in, I think that'll lend to being able to keep him alive is exactly what you were talking about.
I also love Tychus against engaged heavy comps because he's one of the few ranged assassins that can keep on dealing damage while moving using his Q, and I think that cannot be underestimated.
I think you make a valid point. I mean, I think everything that Tempest has going for them in terms of their draft between the Tassadar, the Tychus, and then it's going to be the ultimate X factor with Kerrigan.
Yeah, and Kerrigan is one of the heroes that we have to, again, watch out for. She is amazing on this map in particular. You can use your Ravage, you can use your Q to just keep yourself alive, to hop and have the mobility.
Right.
And that is backed up by very, very nice range damage, too.
All right, Jehao, it is time to tell us what your prediction is going to be.
Tempest is strong, and I love the power of Tychus with that Tassadar. Thank you for that tip. I believe, Wolf, I'm going with Tempest.
Tempest definitely the favorite team. I think I'm rooting for the underdog. I really love them, and I think this is a cool comp to see. Going to be a lot of aggression, going to be a lot of fun. I think they can do it.
All right, and Todd?
All you tryhards can keep on predicting Tempest. I think the hoodie stays it all. He's going to be E-Star all the way for me.
All right, and I'm actually going to join forces with Todd here. I think E-Star has what it takes to really make a name for themselves and win game number one here on Infernal Shrines. However, for now, we're going to throw it over to the next casting duo. That is, of course, Gillyweed and Kalaris.
Korea versus China now to find out who is moving on into the grand final. Gillyweed was hidden behind a sign, but now we found her. How are you doing, Gilly?
I am doing great. I love both of these compositions. I have the E-Star sign, but I love both of these teams too. It's going to be a tough one for me to commentate, but we'll get it done.
I'm sure we will. We are getting on to Infernal Shrines for game number one in this best of five semifinals. To the left-hand side, it will be Tempest with Dami on Kerrigan, Lockdown on Tychus, Hyde will be playing Rhaegar, Duk Duk will be on Tassadar, and finally, Honkono will be on Muradin.
And in the red, we have E-Star, as well as the pause.
This happens.
It does happen.
From time to time.
We gotta wait to introduce E-Star until the game is ready so we can get hyped about this awesome team.
So when I looked at the draft, Gilly, I don't know about you, but I really, really liked the way in which Tempest actually picked Muradin Tassadar to start things off, because it's a very flexible pick as Tassadar, and I almost feel as if they were baiting out the idea of an Illidan ban in the second rotation, because obviously it couples up very well. It's still open, and they were always going to try and go for a melee assassin, I feel, with a Tassadar, but yeah, baiting out that ban means that they have freedom to get Kerrigan, which is really good on this map.
Yeah, it went either way, right? Like, if it stays out, then they get it, and they have a lot of tools that they want to support it, as well as one of the best heroes to counter it. But if they bait out the ban, then that's great, because they have Tassadar, who, you're right, does synergize really well with Kerrigan, helps her out in being able to stay in with her Maelstrom longer so that she can build up her own shielding later on.
I can foresee a world here on Infernal Shrines where Kerrigan lands the sickest combos against a full melee composition. There is that potential to come out from them, but now we get back into game number one, Gilly.
All right, well, with that, let's introduce E-Star in the red, with Tiger playing Karazim, Nightjawn, Tyrael, Zhao Ti playing Sonya, Tumi playing Zul, and Xingxi playing Greymane.
All right, this is going to be exciting. I'm interested to see how Tiger's going to play out on the Karazim, of course. We saw him a lot on Rhaegar before, and he was quite aggressive. But the Karazim here, just the perfect option to synergize with this kind of heavy melee comp.
I mean, if you want to be aggressive, you need to punch things with Transcendence in order to sufficiently heal. But he's in trouble there. Uses Radiant Dash to get away. Xiaoqi won't be so lucky, though. Tries to Whirlwind to get away from the damage. But Tempest is going to draw first blood.
Yeah, very good start already. Lockdown sticks around for a little bit longer than was expected. Block out of Dami. And does he kill him? Yes, he does. I'm surprised he stuck around for so long, but likewise, Karazim, if we're coming in from the back there, will fall, and this is a bloodbath to start.
Xingxi plays such an amazing Greymane, but he's going to get caught here, and they will take out Dami. It's just trading blows, Kalaris. It's game number one.
Why on earth not? Bring the aggression to each other from the very word go. 3-2 kills to start things off. But actually, across all of the lanes, they've been soaked surprisingly well.
They're making sure they keep up with that soak because they want to keep up in experience, make sure that they have those important talent tiers for every single time we get to the temple phase. And we will be having shrines forming pretty soon. But with Zul, E-Star has a very good advantage when it comes to those shrine phases because he can rotate between lanes and clear those out and try to help his team get ahead in experience.
All right, so Lockdown just going to poke away towards the mid. Looking down the talents, not too much craziness going on any player at all. So not much to really point out there at the moment, but the first shrine is about to pop up towards the top. And Kerrigan has a lot of value up there, especially when she has some talents. At the beginning of the game, not as much though. So Sonya does kind of rule the roost in that regard at the moment.
All right, that's why she is already getting set up at the shrine, and Kerrigan's starting to move in, but we'll see how the rotations come in. As Zul's still in the bottom, Tempest can generally know that Zul is not going to be present here, and they can react accordingly, which is to have Tassadar responding to him in the lanes.
Very much so. That's a double combination coming out from there on towards Zhao Ti, as well as Tiger. Leaping all over the place, though, is Dami, and he's going to actually go down here. E-Star with another kill under their belt, and still, I would say, control of the shrine, considering their comp.
I have just been so excited for this match because these two teams are known for their team fighting. When we saw E-Star taking on MVP Black, even in games they lost, they were winning ridiculous fights with like 5 hit points across the board. They're just so good at spreading out when they need to, getting back and making sure they force their opponents to switch onto a different target.
Tempest here, taking this slow. I think they realize combo-wise that it's not easy for them to really rival this too much. That being said, they forced E-Star off extremely easily there with Kerrigan now rotating up, but there's still some soak advantage on the other side of E-Star. Zul is coming up as well, Gilly.
All right, if he can sneak in and get a bone prison on somebody, that would be a great pick for them to start the crowd control chain. But unfortunately for them, it's Xingxi who's in a bit of trouble as Dami is starting on the chase, but he uses Eyes in the Dark to disengage away from the team and may go back just to try to tap up at the well.
A lot of damage on Tumi at the moment. Karazim comes in to try and save him, but Zul's already going to go in down during all of this, so that will be one one down. And Outy still trying to get away from Dami there. Doesn't quite have a combo to follow up with that for Dami. But they've still wrestled them off this quite well. And to be fair, Tempest did such a good job there, considering that slight disadvantage going into the Shrine phase.
Right, well, Tempest, once they hit four, they picked up Leeching Plasma. And that helped them out so much. They have this double support composition that allows them to get into these long, drawn-out fights, and that was a problem for E-Star. People were heading back to try to tap up at the well, and that made it a 4v5, and that's where they started to lose people. So that's only going to get more, but E-Star, once they start to power up themselves, and hopefully they can get in those sustained fights or try to eliminate somebody very quickly.
That was a pounce and a half there on towards Karazim. He falls very quickly, and a lot of damage going on to Hyde at the moment. Jinxi, though, likewise taking a lot of damage. Greymane's going to end up falling, and NC as well, very, very close to death, and he will end up going down. Tempest already with kill after kill after kill. That's a four-man wipe.
Man, Nitro tried to go back up to use Archangel's Rest to take out Hyde, but it wasn't enough, and now where there was just a Punisher, no Sylvanas, to allow them maybe to get a fort with all of those kills, they're going to take out a fort with the very first Punisher.
Yeah, scared for E-Star if that's how Tempest are going to start approaching this series. A full melee comp to run is a very difficult thing to do. We've seen E-Star do it before, even during this tournament, where they tried to run it on Battlefield, but they were going up against, I would say, a lesser opponent. Now running it against Tempest, they have to have precise execution in these team fights.
Yeah, I mean, they kind of have some supporting from the Tyrael shields, but all in all, with the double support, the way that Tempest are set up, they just can't get into those long, drawn-out fights the way they can't take continued poke as they were in the last one. They need to make sure that they take someone out really as quickly as they can in this team fight.
But I think, as you kind of referenced before, Gilly, the potential for them at level 10 increases severely. I
definitely. Mean,
when they've got Sanctification, even that alone is a huge boon.
And Jinxi gets hit by the combo, but now that Seven's here, Karzim has picked up Cleanse and got him out of trouble, but that is on cooldown now. And you see E-Star disengaging out of this. They know that the potential for combos is severe.
Oh, yes, it is. They've got to be very careful about damning that. Meridian's going to go up to the top. Tassadar's going to be sent towards the bottom. And they are currently a level and a bit ahead here. So Tempest really showing that, well, against the very best of the best, that final that they won in Korea was no fluke.
They've been doing a really good job of keeping up with Zul's split soak too. The fact that not only they've gotten 8 kills to 3, but making sure to keep up with them and not let him just run rampant, forcing Tsubi to get back or have to come up there. And now he's going to get taken out as he gets caught by a force wall and a Kerrigan combo and another kill for Team Tempest.
Combo and no answer, unfortunately. And you can only have, if as a lot of these members get hit in a combo from Kerrigan, there's only one cleanse.
Right.
There is only one cleanse.
Yeah.
So you've got to be very, very careful about how these fights go.
Who does Tiger like the most?
Exactly.
That's what we're going to know. All right, well, second shrine has started to activate. Tiger taking damage from lockdown.
Ooh.
He even drops the drill.
Ooh. He was very close to killing off Karazim, actually, there. He was down to about 5% health. But they do back off on them towards the temple shrine now. And this is almost a guarantee. They don't have level 10, do we start? They can't take this.
Right. They actually are trying to get their bruisers, but Hung Kono doesn't even want to let them do that. And this is something that Hung Kono excels at, is moving away from the team and finding their opponents. He does this all the time. A stun hits Xiao Ti. Can he get away? A great dwarf toss just to try to body block. They've stolen away the bruisers.
Oh, this is such control from Tempest at the moment. They're putting on aggression on towards Xiao Ti. They even saw where Greymane went with Eyes in the Dark. Another force wall on towards Xiao Ti. He just managed to get away for now. You could even see NT coming in to shield him there, making sure he was staying alive for just those split moments.
But all during this time, Tempest were picking up the Punisher, and now they have that. The wall is already down. The bait is going to come in pretty late, and they're going to have to be so careful in how they defend this.
And the combo and that wall as well on towards Dingsy. He's going to have to move away there for a moment. There was already a sanctification actually used, so they can't really do too much as Tempest are still on their doorstep knocking.
You can see the healing ward. Karzim is trying as best as he can just to keep them alive and will land a sick palm, but unfortunately, the zoning was so great. Another force wall. They're like 3 for 3, and Tyrael's going to get taken out.
Danny got a double combo there. I don't think the stun quite followed up on from that primal grasp, but that's a fort guaranteed. And, I mean, Dami jumping from wall to the fort as well. Every little thing is just going Tempest way.
Duck Duck's force walls are ridiculous.
Yeah.
That's like the fourth one that's equal to kill. It's not even that they're catching people. He's killing. They are for sure getting kills off of these. This is unbelievable.
You remember, I mean, even though in the previous series he played, he was still always on point with his fourth wall.
Yeah.
And I mean, considering it's on, what, a very, very short cooldown, he can do that for days and days and days.
Yeah, every 12 seconds. And the ability to split out this heavy melee composition from E-Star is pretty scary, but at least they have heroic abilities. Unfortunately for them, they are about to be down another talent here, and if they can't get 13 in time for the next temple phase, they're once again faced with the problem of, do we give this up? Do we try to fight down a talent here? And that's Tempest running this game.
Yep, it is difficult at the moment for E-Star to gather any traction, and especially now since they've committed so heavily to this melee comp. I just think, again, they have to be fearful of the Kerrigan. I almost would have rather banned out Kerrigan than Illidan, considering the potential of combos, especially like that once again. It's not the most fair fight here, though, for Tempest. They are 3v5 at the moment, with two more retreat falling on down towards the bottom.
That's a huge combo, and they immediately have to use Sanctification, but they found Dami, who has to get healed up by Ancestral Healing. Dami is going back, and they're at least just trying to take her down the shielding, keeping her alive somehow, some way. Karazim will drop. Nyjah goes down, too. They at least get Rhaegar, so it's a 2-for-2.
Yeah, 2-for-2. There was a combo on towards two of them, and it looks like Dami's going to retreat back, but actually tap, and then maybe join the fight once again here. Charity as well as Tumi do not want to be sticking around for long, especially with Dami having that wave to eventually... Look how fast he clears that. Good God, Dami. Click, click, click.
Yeah, that's why Kerrigan, this is the only battleground, really, we see her on. Maybe, maybe a tomb, maybe. But this is the one where she is. She's really much more prioritized. And I have to highlight, though, E-Star did that. They took two heroes, they lost two, but in that situation where they are that behind, that was a good trade for them. Now they have 13 talents in time for the Shrine.
And now on the other side of for Tempest, of course, they do have a Viscerate on Kerrigan's side of things, which increases her jump by 40% range. So now there is the potential for them to even land these combos easier as they do continue on against this fight. Jinxy up towards the top gets missed by that Stormbolt. Hong Chono will move out.
Tychus is going for the bigger they are build, which then leads into Spray and Pray, and then at 16, he'll be able to pick up armor-piercing rounds. It's, there's two different Tychus builds we see, but this one's really able to do a lot of just a really quick single target, burn down a target up in front, and that can spell a lot of trouble for somebody like Tyrael.
I'm really fearful for them if they don't actually deal with this Kerrigan, because the combos are just going to keep coming out, and they need to focus on a target very, very quickly. That's going to be a combo, but actually not even hitting Tiger properly there. He will get away from that. Big AoE damage coming out as well. Dami's taking a lot here. E-Star really piling on the pressure. They get Dami. That's the perfect answer for them to start this fight off.
That Sanctification was so perfect. They found Dami in a terrible spot. I was separated away from the team, but now Jinxy's kind of in the same situation. Oh. Tiger gets hit by the palm, but that, they just switch targets and Hyde takes down Jinxy, but he's going to get too far forward. He will go down. So is Karazim. Another bloodbath. 2-for-2.
Exactly. 2-for-2. The AoE damage coming out once again from Tychus against this full melee comp was doing work with that grenade, hitting like four of them and killing off one as Hong Kono once again goes forward looking for Tumi. Very quite low, but he will be able to get away for the moment here. These three on the side of Tempest are running the roost here.
Right. It's a 2-for-2, but even when you lose the support on one side, Zul goes down and all of a sudden a 2-for-3. Mm-hmm. But even though Tempest lose their support, and so does E-Star, Tempest still has Tassadar shielding.
Yep.
He can help keep everybody alive, and that's where you saw the three members who were still up from Tempest much healthier than the three who were left from E-Star. Now with this, they're going to be able to get 16 and another Punisher.
And I'm really interested to see throughout this series how highly Tempest values Tassadar, because throughout the majority of the tournament, he's fallen off of a little bit for a lot of teams, but Tempest, they're currently Korean champions, and in this game, they're utilizing him very, very strongly with Duk-Duk.
They also played him 3 out of the 4 games that they've played in this tournament so far, so it's the only hero that they have prioritized as much is Muradin, and with good reason. That was something that they were even doing in the Super League Finals, and look where that got them.
Yeah, it got them a lot of money, and probably even more here as they continue on now. Punisher jumping across the wall. They want to bring down that wall to Tempest to try and get in on this force here. Landing a Stormer. Will he get a combo? Yes, they do. On towards Tyrael by the looks of things. He does make himself invulnerable with that Sanctification, but the wall is still splitting them off. They're so clumped up, they're taking huge AoE damage.
Oh, there's this Tyrael going down. Ancestral Healing will connect. Sonya is going to be the next one to fall, and this looks trouble for E-Star as they take out Karazim. Only Zul and Greymane remaining, and they are trying to chase down Zul. They won't get a kill on him, but for sure they're getting a keep.
19 kills to 7 with 2 level lead. Not even level 16 hitting for E-Star at all. They'll take down this fort. They're going to go on towards core as well here. And E-Star, with their tail between the legs, they're going to have a very difficult time of being shutting this down.
These teams have never played before. They've never even scrimmed each other before.
Right.
So this is fully a battle of styles. And as Greymane goes down, we can see that in this instance, the battle of styles is going the way it is for Tempest, because they are going to walk home with game number 1.
Yes, they they are, unless they find some miracle, but that is not likely. There's too much damage on the side of Tempest. That core will fall, and Game Number One goes over to Tempest here in this best of five. The Korean champions look strong there.
They did look very strong, and I remember, I think it was the versus MVP Black again in the grand finals when they did the exact same thing on Shrines. They played Kerrigan, they put Dami on her, and I remember Wolf and Artosis. I almost called him Artanis again. Why do I keep doing that?
Close name.
Well, I remember Wolf and Artosis being like, oh, I don't know about this Kerrigan, and then like being a total believer. And you know what? Oh. I'm a believer now too.
Oh, this map, I've been a believer of Kerrigan for a long time. We saw it a lot in the European scene. Not quite as executed to the level as you're going to see a Tempest execute it, yeah, for sure. And the way they were able to run that on Dami. Believer as well. But for now, we can head over to the panel to see exactly what they think about game number one between Tempest and E-Star.